stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic on which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Story.
Welcome.
Okay, we'll move on to item two, presentations. We have the introduction. And actually, I'm going to stop right there. There are a few announcements, I believe, our clerk wanted to notify us. Chloe?
Yes, can everyone hear me?
We can.
Thank you for waiting for our technology. Hello, welcome to our meeting. In accordance with the current Santa Cruz County Health Order and the Governor's Executive Order N-2920, this meeting is not physically open to the public. Council and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are several ways for the public to watch and participate. Information on how to join the meeting using Zoom or a landline mobile phone, along with how to submit public comment during the meeting tonight, is available on our website, cityofcapitola.org, on the slides now shown or shown earlier this evening, and on the published meeting agenda. As always, this meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV Channel 8 and is being recorded to be rebroadcast on the following Wednesday at 8 a.m. and on Saturday following the first rebroadcast at 1 p.m. on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast Channel 25. Meetings can be viewed live from the city's website as well. Our technician tonight is Noelle Cave. Thank you for being with us. And I'll turn it back to you, Mayor Brooks. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, if we can just make sure everyone is on mute, that is in attendance today. Okay, so item 2A, introduction of our new employee accounts clerk, Leda Laidlaw Hunter. Do we have a staff presentation on this?
Yes, thank you, Mayor Brooks. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. It is my pleasure this evening to introduce Leda Laidlaw Hunter as our new account clerk in the Finance Department. Leda previously worked as a payroll administrator at a local business for a little over a year before joining the city. Prior to that, Leda spent 20 years in the retail industry, managing various Ross stores within the region for 6 years, and then 14 years as the manager of the Santa Cruz Marshals. Leda started with the city on December 28th and has already been instrumental in helping us get 2021 business licenses processed. Leda, who is an avid reader, enjoys reading in her spare time, and we are extremely excited to have Leda join our team, so please help me in welcoming Leda to Capitola. Thank you.
Yay. Welcome, Leda. Would you like to say a few words?
Yes, thank you. I'm really excited to be a part of this team.
Wonderful. Well, welcome. We're so happy to have you. Now we're going to move to item 2B, introduction of new employee personnel analyst Renee DeMar. Do you have a staff presentation?
Good evening, Mayor Brooks and council members. I'd like to introduce Renee DeMar. She is the City of Capitola's new personnel analyst. Renee comes to us with over 10 years of HR management experience and staff development, leadership training, and employee relations, most recently with a local nonprofit. Renee has also served as a career management consultant for the City of Sunnyvale's Nova Works and has developed a number of pilot programs for the Packard Foundation while instructing at Cabrillo College. In her personal life, she's a sailor, an ocean kayaker, and an avid gardener. In fact, she used to be a choreographer, so she loves to dance as well. Renee started on December 28th as well. Please help us welcome Renee to the team. We are looking forward to her contributions in navigating as we're finding out daily the increasingly complicated world of human resources. So, thank you.
Thank you. Welcome, Renee. Would you like to say a few words?
Just so happy to be here, and thank you.
You're welcome. Well, welcome aboard. Now we'll go ahead and move on to item 2C, presentation from the Santa Cruz Metropolitan Transit District CEO, Alex Clifford.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, council members, City Manager Goldstein. Good to be here. I appreciate the invitation to annually present the state of Metro, and obviously this would be a very interesting year to provide you an update on the state of Metro Shall I share my screen?
I believe you have permission, Larry, is that true?
Can you see that okay?
Great, we can see your screen.
Excellent, let's go to the presentation form here. So one of the things that we are certainly trying to sort our way through right now is the post-COVID environment. What does it look like? Certainly, nobody really knows. There's not much history with anything like this. We have more questions than answers. We know a little bit about economic recovery from the Great Recession, roughly 2008 to 2014, but certainly the COVID impacts on the economy are just nothing like that. And then, of course, in 2009, we had the swine flu, H1N109 pandemic. It was a pandemic, but it never got this bad. And then, of course, in 2005, there was the avian flu, and of course, it was not this bad either. So we always want to do the right thing, same thing as you're doing in the city. We want to protect our employees and customers. We want to take great care for the public trust, thoughtfulness, do the right thing, and minimize costly mistakes. And we think we'll make our best decisions by drawing from and sharing with our experiences with other transit agencies across the nation. And we've been doing that for months in various forums, national, state, and local. So for Metro, our initial strategy looks like this. Phase one is to restore public and customer confidence in a safe experience when riding the bus. Phase two is added value, and then phase three is what we call the post-COVID transit service. We'll talk a little bit about those. So restoring public confidence. Metro committed to the principles of the American Public Transit Association health and safety program. We received their certificate, and we proudly display that on all of our buses, including some of our advertising spaces on the buses. The goal here is to help the riding public, that is the part of the riding public that have returned to their jobs or they are essential and have continued to go to their jobs. We want them to feel comfortable that at Metro, we're doing everything we can to keep them safe when they board our bus and ride it to the destination and then home again later that day. You've probably seen these ads on all of our buses, deliberately disinfecting, seriously sanitizing, and serious about safety. Those are on our buses that travel throughout the county. Again, trying to send a message of confidence to our customers that it is okay to ride the buses. So in addition to sort of social distancing on the buses, if you will, you'll notice in this picture that there are blocked seats where we don't want people to sit. We have capacity constrained all of our buses, and the bus operators, if they achieve capacity, primarily usually during the peak hour, morning or PM, they are allowed to pass up stops and not pick up any other customers. In addition, what we did is on all of our buses, 100% of our fleet, we put these plastic between row seat barriers, sneeze barriers in, so that when somebody is sitting behind you, they're within 6 feet of you, but now you have a sneeze barrier to help protect you further. Every night, the picture on the left is one of our vehicle service workers fogging the vehicle with a disinfectant. Every night, every vehicle gets fogged with disinfectant. And then in addition to that, you'll see that we've installed hand sanitizer dispensers by the fare box on every bus so that our customers can sanitize their hands. In addition to that, we've hired a number of what we call cleaners. They're temp employees, and they're stationed at our transit centers, Watsonville, Capitola Mall, Scotts Valley, and Pacific Station. And every time a bus comes into the terminal, these cleaners jump on that bus. They have a bucket of disinfectant. They dip their rag in that bucket. And then quickly, while that bus is there for a few moments, they run through the bus and they disinfect all the high-touch surfaces. So not only are our buses disinfected so that in the morning when they go out, they're completely safe, but we know that germs can transfer throughout the day. So
Our buses go through the terminals many times throughout the day, and they get this additional disinfecting. In addition to that, to protect our bus operators, months ago, we installed these clear plastic curtains. And again, they are to shield our bus operators from airborne droplets. So what the bus operators do, by the way, is each time they pull up to a stop, they deploy the curtain while people board and pay their fare. And then when everybody is seated and the driver gets ready to pull away from the stop, they roll back the curtain for safety reasons so that they can drive and not have an obstructed view. And of course, for months, actually since the county mandated that everybody who is at a bus stop or riding a bus or driving a bus must have a face covering, we have posted signs on our buses inside and out mandating face covering, and also the principle that no mask, no ride. So the bus operators are empowered to refuse a ride. So back in October, of course, we didn't know that we were going to hit this next phase and go backwards, really sort of following Halloween. In October, we said, hey, we've done all of these really wonderful things to our buses to make them safe for our customers to return. Ridership is down enormously, and for that percentage of our population that are holding back, they are going to work, but they have not been riding the bus because they might have been concerned. We wanted to let them know all of these things that I just shared with you and encourage them to come back to riding the service. We got good media coverage out of that event too. So our second phase, which we have started and we are in now, which is added value. One of the ways to attract customers back to the bus is to give them more value than they had before. Certainly, in this environment, contactless, touchless technology is really important. We already have some of that in what we call our smart cards, where people can load fare media on a smart card and they can tap it and their fare is acknowledged. But we're looking at other ways to move to mobile ticketing so that our customers can use their cell phones. We actually have launched now our pilot project, and it's going really well, and we expanded it to the entire system, and we'll keep growing that, including moving to the next phase, which is called a validation phase. We're also exploring taking a proposal to the board to expand Wi-Fi. Right now you have Wi-Fi on our Highway 17 commuter service, but we don't have it on the fixed route. So we'll be bringing a proposal to the board to spend a little bit of money to expand Wi-Fi to our entire system. And we're also looking at automatic passenger counters. We'll bring a proposal sometime this year to the board for installation of these. Now, these collect information about boardings and alighting. That's useful for us in planning the service. But more importantly, in this COVID environment, with that app that we are in the process of finalizing, where you can tell when your bus is coming and where your bus is, you will also see how many people are on that bus. So if by chance your comfort level is a lower number of people on the bus than the app shows there are, you can choose to wave the bus by and wait for the next bus. But we're giving our customers the opportunity to make a decision about whether they want to board that bus or not. So that's really cool, and we hope to get the board's approval later on. We're redesigning all of our bus stops. We have board approval already on that. We're going to spend a little money. They're going to look a lot nicer, and they're going to be a lot more functional. We also opened up kiosks at our two transit centers where customers can come up to what looks like a Ring doorbell, if you will, and they can communicate and ask questions of our customer service right there at the transit centers. And then I spoke earlier about the automatic vehicle location, which has already been funded and is in the final stages of installation on all of our buses. So then phase three gets a little tricky because, you know, we don't know when we're going to come out of COVID, and we don't know what ridership is going to look like on the other side of COVID. But we're actually beyond what this says, evaluating on-demand service. We're bringing a proposal to the board at their meeting on the 22nd of this month to do a pilot project of several different on-demand service projects throughout the county, what is often called microtransit. And one of those particular zone will extend from 41st Avenue to La Selva Beach and from the coast to 3/4 mile of the SoCal Drive. And in effect, it's on demand. It's almost like an Uber-like service where you can call and schedule your service and be picked up. You'll pay a little bit more. You'll pay a premium for that. But we'll get that started if the board likes that proposal. And then as much as is financially feasible, we are trying to put back all or most of the service possible that we had in place before COVID. Why is that important? Well, it's important because even though putting it back now means I might be running a lot of empty buses, it's important because when that customer is ready to get back on the bus, the service needs to be there. What we don't want to do is encounter overload and then go through a 3 to 6 month process to put service back on the street. We want that service ready for them when they need it. So, for example, as we come out of the shelter in place, again, at some point here, hopefully in the near future, our customers in varying degrees will go back to work. They'll need that bus to be there, and we want that bus to be there for them. We're gonna be looking at service frequencies. Our customer survey that we did during the COVID environment during this pandemic revealed that customers want more frequent service on the line. And then we're gonna try to improve our on-time performance. We have always operated from some minor sampling and anecdotal data to try to determine if we're running on time. The new technology I talked about earlier will get us data telling us where we're running on time and allow us to use that data to make adjustments to the runtime of the bus lines so that we can perform better. If we are performing better and delivering more of an on-time service, that's an incentive for our customers to come back. We're rethinking the role and the functionality of our two major transit centers, Watsonville and Pacific Station. I don't know if we'll ever reopen the lobbies. We may be doing things different in the post-COVID environment. And then we're even rethinking ticket vending machines, paper fare media, cash and coins, all of that hopefully migrating more towards the cashless, touchless smart cards and the mobile applications. And then of course we're working with the RTC on Bus on Shoulder, which will hopefully create a South County to North County, North County to South County express line on Bus on Shoulder on the highway in a few years or so. This graph here shows you what's been going on with ridership. The yellow line is just a piece of data that tells us what we're doing relative to pass-ups. We were tracking how many people we were having to pass up, and you can see we did actually have a spike there, and we adjusted our service, and you can see that that worked, and the pass-ups actually decreased. But what you also see here, using the data that's on the screen, is that since we went back into a shelter in place, our ridership, which was gradually, it's nothing dramatic, and it's well below, way below what it was a year ago, but it was gradually creeping up. And then with the shelter in place, we started to drop off again. Ridership is right now, year over year, about 85% below. So that's we have a lot of room to attract our customers back. So, what is the current state of Metro's budget? Well, our preliminary estimate as of December 31st, our total revenues are down about $1.3 million. That's predominantly the fares that people pay in a fare box. Again, we're down 85% ridership. And then, of course, our two education institutions, Cabrillo College and UCSC. So all of the revenues that come from there combined make us down about $1.3 million. Now, offsetting that, we've been managing our budget very carefully. We've been trimming wherever we can overtime, eliminating costs, eliminating travel, that's a no-brainer. And we've been able, through December 31st, to come in $3.2 million below budget, so that's all good news. So all in all, at the end of the calendar year, we're about $1.8 million favorable. So we want to keep managing that budget carefully as we try to get through this and hopefully stave off what we think is an impending fiscal crisis coming. So you've probably heard about the omnibus bill that passed Congress and was signed by the president. Omnibus meaning that it accomplished multiple things within this one bill. So you pass one bill and multiple things are accomplished. Here's two of them. There was an Emergency Coronavirus Relief Act, and there was the 20 2021 federal budget. These are all included in the omnibus bill. So in the COVID stimulus dollars, you probably know we got CARES Act money a number of months ago. This is sort of a second round of money. We're still waiting for final determination from the FTA, but it looks like when I wrote this, it looked like we were going to get about $12 million. Actually, we fine-tuned that a little bit more based on some information that was published, and we think that's about $13.5 million. So that combined with CARES will help us to try to achieve our goal, which is to push off the fiscal crisis, deliver as much service as we can, avoid laying off and furloughing our drivers, and bridging, drawing down on that money to bridge the deficit that will occur each month. And hopefully at some point here, the economy on the other side of COVID starts recovering to the point where when we exhaust these reserves, the economy will be back to something resembling pre-COVID and life goes on. So these will be monies to help us accomplish that. Also within the federal FY21 budget, there was a transit component. Because we run our buses, most of our buses on compressed natural gas, we get a fuel credit each year. It's an extender, it has to be renewed every year. That's about $300,000 that will come to Metro this year that we'll use on the capital side of our budget. And then there's this thing called plus-ups. So the FAST Act is the authorization that occurs every 3 to 5 years that funds transportation. And then when you have plus-ups, it means that the federal government has said, we'll take what the FAST Act authorizes and we'll give you a little bit more. So this budget bill gave us a little bit more, nationwide $198 million. That translates into about $205,000 to us. Every little bit helps, and that'll help us on the operating and capital side. And then there are competitive programs that we apply for grants, sometimes called discretionary. They also receive plus-ups of about $125 million for bus and bus facilities and $125 million for LONO. You may recall in 2016, we got a LONO grant for electric buses. And this year, we're going to be applying for a bus and bus facilities grant to build a new paratransit facility at near Dominican. So, you know, vote root for us. We're really excited about that. And we're as we speak, we are putting together that shovel-ready project and getting it up to 30 or 40% readiness. So I would just close with that, that all Santa Cruz Metro dedicated employees are frontline heroes delivering essential services. I want to thank you for allowing Ed Bottorf to serve on our board for all the years that he did. He represented you well. He did well for us and for you. And we're really excited to have Councilmember Peterson aboard. And she's already been working for you. She was at our committees last week. So, Madam Mayor and council members, I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Mr. Clifford. We are equally as excited to have Councilwoman Peterson on the board with you as well. Council members, do we have any questions for Mr. Clifford at this time? Okay, I see Councilmember Sam Story's, Vice Mayor Story's hand raised.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Alex, thank you for that presentation and under difficult times, bringing us that information and update. I was particularly interested in the on-demand service that you're proposing to implement in 2021. And my question was whether that was going to be a door-to-door service or a stop-to-stop service, or is it too early to even be able to answer that question?
We're still fine-tuning that, but it should be a door-to-door service.
Yeah, kind of like Paracruz service for the general?
Well, coincidentally, now that you mentioned that, we are using our Paracruz vehicles and drivers to pull this off. As a result of the COVID environment, we have the excess capacity, and we're going to move that excess capacity over to on-demand.
Excellent. I think that's very creative thinking and a way out of this post-COVID period. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you,
Vice Mayor Story. I believe I saw a council member Bertrand's hand. Council member Bertrand, you're muted.
Well, Alex, I'm interested in your special facility that you're going to be putting in at Dominican. If you could expand on that, what kind of services are you going to be providing, and what's the nature of the building? Is this you're renting it, you're owning it? Is it a partnership with the hospital? Just give me a little more understanding. It sounds very exciting.
It is really exciting. So off of SoCal Drive, we have a park and ride lot, if you will, that we've owned for many, many years. It didn't work as a Caltrans park and ride lot, and many years predating me. It was handed over to Metro, and we used it as somewhat of a park and ride lot with years and years ago when we had some service that went through there. That service ended up being non-productive and was terminated. And so the lot over the years, particularly the last 6.5 years that I've been here, has increasingly become a nuisance with all sorts of transients and whatnot moving in there. One time we caught somebody rebuilding their engine in there. It was just a mess. And so we started looking at that. What should we do with it? Well, in parallel with that, we've been leasing for years over at Research Park a facility that we operate our paratransit services out of. And we just have been having a struggle with that landlord. We've been under threat that he's not going to renew that lease. And we need to really control our own destiny, we said. So the two came together in sync perfectly. We have a lot that we don't know what to do with. It's surplus. And we have an immediate need to find a place to relocate our paratransit. We looked all over Mid-County. We think paratransit should be located in Mid-County for dispatching purposes. So we looked all over trying to find another place to move to. We couldn't find one. And this just became a beautiful solution. Took it to the board, got their approval. What it is we'll locate all of the paratransit, the vehicles and the staff, into this new building that we will build and own on our land. And because Pacific Avenue is undergoing some discussion about the future of that facility, and the future facility may not have room for our customer service function, we're going to move our customer service function into that building. In addition to that, we're going to do all of our ADA certification out of that building, and we'll invite customers to come there to be trained on how to ride our service. So if you are in a wheelchair or other devices, we can help you safely learn how to board buses or use our paratransit service. So it'll be a multi-functioning facility. Located right there. We'll park all of our vans, all 43 of our paracruise vans, and of course we'll do our dispatching for this on-demand service out of there. So it's just a fantastic thing. What we need, it can't come together unless we get that bus and bus facilities grant. We're going to go at it real aggressive. We're going to apply for that this year, and we're going to overmatch. We're going to use more local funds than the minimum they require in order to try to make it a very competitive grant. So hang on, hopefully around September, October this year, I really hope I'll have some great news to report.
Well, that sounds like you're going to get it with that kind of enthusiasm. Thank you very much.
You bet, John.
Thank you, Mr. Clifford. Councilwoman Peterson.
I just wanted to say thank you for being here today and providing that presentation. I'm really excited to learn more about the future of Metro, especially the Wi-Fi on the fixed routes and the bus on shoulder. I think these are both great opportunities for our community and our region. So I'm looking forward to learning more in my time on the board.
Great. Thank you for joining us.
Great. Any other questions for Mr. Clifford? Okay, seeing none. Thank you, Mr. Clifford, so much for your time today.
Thank you. Stay safe.
Thank you. Okay, we're now going to move on to item 3, report out on closed session. Staff, do we have a report?
Dan, I believe you're muted.
Sorry, council heard the two items listed on the agenda in closed session, and direction was given to staff.
Thank you, Samantha. Okay, we're on item number 4, additional materials. Any additional materials for us today?
Yes, there was one additional material regarding item 9D. An updated contract was sent out earlier today.
Thank you. And on to item 5, additions and deletions to the agenda. Do we have any additions and or deletions to the agenda?
Staff has no proposed changes to the agenda this evening.
Thank you, Jamie. Okay, now on to item 6, public comments. This is an opportunity for public comments. Do we have any public comments that of items not on today's agenda?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anybody in attendance with their hand raised asking to speak on this item, and I do not see any emails on this item.
Thank you very much. Okay, now on to item 7, City Council and staff comments. Do we have any staff comments this evening?
I believe we have two comments this evening for you. The first one is Director Jesberg on a public works project.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I'm happy to report that on Wednesday we received 9 bids on Capitola Avenue sidewalk project. The engineer's estimate on that project was $116,000, and the low bid came just under that at $115,250. So it's good news. It's a contractor that's done some private work in the city before, but we've never worked with them, and we're excited to work with them. Because the bid was lower than the budget amount approved by the council, we do not need to return to approve a contract. So we will proceeding to award a contract and anticipate construction probably starting in 6 to 8 weeks, unless we hopefully get some more rain, which would delay that. But it should be ready to roll weather-wise in 6 to 8 weeks. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. And is it Nikki?
Yes, good evening, Mayor Brooks, council members. Capitola Recreation, in partnership with the Art and Cultural Commission, hosted Reflections of 2020 Art Contest. And today, we announced the winners of the first phase of our digital gallery, and I wanted to share the first place winners for each of the divisions. So if you'll bear with me for a quick second. Now, this first prize winner is for the professional division, titled COVID Diaries Number 7, Vote, Make a Plan by Myra Eastman. This is the first prize winner for the novice division, titled Be of Good Courage by Terry Goldner Robbins. And this one is the first prize winner for the youth division, titled The Mask by Isla Bonney. I'm excited about the outcome of this, and all of these pieces, as well as 15 other recognized top ranked, we'll move on to the next phase of the art contest, which will be the public's choice display. The date for that event is to be determined in when COVID is a more safe for us to gather and share these in person. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nikki. Those are incredible. Thank you so much for sharing those with us. Any other staff comments? Okay, seeing none, we'll go ahead and move on to City Council comments. Council Member Bertrand, I see your hand is raised.
It is. Well, my daughter was part of the sailing program that is out of the harbor, and it's been running for years. It's volunteer pretty much, and at least at the time my daughter was in it, it didn't cost anything except the parents had to provide insurance. So I'd like to give a shout out to the surfers who recently rescued quite a few of the young sailors. They had a big problem getting in. They ended up in the water, and thank heavens those surfers were there. It was right at the entrance. They could have been hitting up against the rocks. They helped avoid a horrible situation. So shout out to the local surfers who helped out with that. I don't know who they are, but I was glad they were there.
Thank
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other council comments? Okay, seeing none, I'm just going to go ahead and add that Gray Bears is looking for volunteers at this time. They're looking for drivers and volunteers to work in their store, amongst several other things. So if you're interested in volunteering, please contact Gray Bears, or you can contact the Volunteer Center, who's currently looking for additional volunteers to support seniors in our community. I just found out that the number one need of seniors in our community is help around the home, and because Helping Hands through the Volunteer Center cannot assist seniors right now because of the pandemic, they're looking for others to assist them. So if you have time, please do so. I also see Councilwoman Peterson's hand up. Did you have another council comment?
Yeah, I just briefly wanted to share my thanks for the healthcare workers in our county. Within the last couple weeks, I was at the Dominican Emergency Room for nothing serious, luckily, but it was the staff and healthcare workers there are working so incredibly hard to serve everyone that was there. In the 4 hours I was there, I was never able to get into a room because they are absolutely packed. In walking through the emergency room to radiology, at least half of the people that I passed were on ventilators or some kind of breathing tube, and it was absolutely terrifying, but they were working so incredibly hard. And so I just want to give an extra thank you to the staff and the healthcare workers at Dominican and throughout our county, and to remind everyone to continue to stay vigilant, wear your mask, stay 6 feet apart, stay home, wash your hands, everything that we've been saying for almost a year now. Please continue to do so so that we can try to be over this as soon as possible. And the ultimate point I just wanted to make here was to say thank you to all of our healthcare workers and first responders during this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Okay, seeing no other city council comments, we're gonna move on to item 8. This is the consent calendar. All items listed in the consent calendar will be enacted by one motion in the form listed below on our agenda tonight. There will be no separate discussion on these items prior to the time the council votes on the action unless members of the city council request specific items to be discussed for separate review. Items pulled for separate discussion will be considered following general government. So with that being said, can I have a motion for the consent calendar?
Yeah, Mayor, I had a question on a couple of the items.
Okay, and what items did you have questions on?
First on the minutes, item A.
Okay, are we looking at a correction, council member Story?
Yes.
Okay, and you had a question on another item as well?
Yes, on item C, the audit report.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and I'm going to look for a motion for just item 8 B at this time. Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Can I have a second? Okay. And are there any comments from, or excuse me, public comments at this time?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anyone asking for a comment, either attendees or via email at this time.
Okay, so we'll come back to council for approval of item 8B. Can I have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Councilmember Kaiser, you're muted.
Sorry.
Aye.
Thank you. Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
And Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, we're going to go ahead and move on to item 9 for general government. And we're going to begin with item 9A. Consider extending the temporary COVID outdoor activities and encroachment agreement to a date certain. Do we have a staff report?
Yes. Can you hear me okay?
I
can hear you.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor Brooks and Council. Before you tonight, we have an extension of our COVID-19 temporary use permits and encroachment agreements. Sorry, I'm having a, there we go. And I also want to check, can you see my screen okay?
We cannot see your screen.
I'm not, okay, let me. Sorry about that. Okay, let's try that again. Now, can you see my screen? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Tonight, we're going to discuss the extension of COVID-19 temporary use permits and encroachment permits. As you'll recall, back in May of 2020, the City Council directed staff to allow restaurants and other businesses to utilize outdoor spaces to prevent the spread of COVID-19 and for safety reasons. On June 2nd, we passed, the City Council, we passed the emergency order number 4 of 2020, which allowed COVID-19 outdoor activities and encroachment agreements. And there was a great effort by the BIA, the local businesses and staff. And you see in these pictures here, some of the local members of the BIA putting together stanchions and really converting our outdoor space along the Esplanade and then throughout the city of Capitola. In total to date, we have 29 businesses, and I hear there's another one jumping aboard. So 30 businesses that have taken advantage of these COVID-19 temporary use permits. The types of businesses that have been utilizing them are restaurants, nail and hair salons, massage parlors. So they've been very useful and helpful. And there have been some temporary sales that have occurred as well. Within our permit, there is a limit to the activities that it was, the initial agreement was put in place through September 30th of 2020 with automatic extensions through the life of the state county mandated social distancing requirements. So every month we renew, we extend this allowance. And I will say that I do get regular questions from different businesses asking how much longer will this be in place? And there's some, you know, and the answer is until, you know, social distancing is no longer required. So tonight we're here to discuss, to get direction on whether or not we should extend these permits to a date certain. By extending the permits to a date certain, this will provide better certainty for our businesses towards decision making. There are a lot of financial decisions that businesses put in place of winterizing their space. You'll notice many of the spaces have the character of the business brought outside and how much to invest into that space and their improvements. And then also staff determinations. As they're utilizing that space, it takes more staffing. So getting more clarity on the when the this will come to an end would be helpful for all the businesses in making decisions. Our staff recommendation this evening is to extend the permit through May 31st, 2021. And the reason for this date is because throughout the summer, we have multiple special events in the city of Capitola, and many of them are along the Esplanade. And that's where the majority of the restaurants in which they're utilizing that outdoor space that is on the street is. And then knowing that if the social distancing and the shelter in place are still in place, we can come back to the City Council prior to the May 31st to extend this deadline further. But at this point, we think the 31st would be a good date just in case, you know, things change dramatically and we're able to gather this summer. Other
some of our neighbors have made these decisions to make permanent dates. Scotts Valley extended their permits through May 30th, the city of Santa Cruz through October 30th. So in comparing those dates, we also looked at the fiscal impact that this would bring to the city. To extend through May, there would be a loss. I think it's 23% of our parking spaces are utilized for the outdoor dining. And so the loss to the city through May would be $55,000 to $60,000 based on a 23% decrease over the year before's numbers. And through June through October, if we were to extend it through October, would there be an additional loss of another $65,000 to $70,000? So with that, staff is recommending that the council direct staff to prepare documentation for consideration for at a future council meeting to extend the temporary permits and encroachment agreements through May 31st, 2020. We will be coming back once we get direction. We'll work with the city attorney on exactly in what format we need to bring this back to the city council and come back probably at the next meeting or shortly thereafter. Implemented this evening. So thank you. I'm available for questions.
Thank you, Katie. Just to remind everyone, if you can stay muted at this time, I'm hearing a little background noise. So this is a time for council questions. I see council member Peterson's hand raised.
Yeah, I just wanted to confirm. So I know right now we're not under the current health order. For our region, even outdoor dining isn't permitted, but I'm assuming that once it is again, this would allow them to do that. And my guess is, and if you could confirm that even though outdoor dining isn't permitted at this time, extending these temporary use permits would still be possible for the businesses that are allowed to remain open, and it would just provide them space outside, correct?
Correct. So even though right now you're absolutely correct that outdoor dining is not allowed, it's to-go services. And right now our sites in the village have been modified to curbside pickup,
yeah,
just to accommodate that. But yes, yeah, so once we move from a shelter in place and back to, I think it was the purple level, where you were allowed to have outdoor dining, once they reopen outdoor dining and allow it, we could reopen these spaces and they could take advantage of it. We actually wanted to do this now while it's to get ahead of it so that businesses can be preparing.
Great. Thank you.
Any other council questions? Okay, seeing none. I did have two questions for you, Katie. Are the permits for the outdoor dining, they're still free, is that correct?
That is correct, yeah.
And then what did you mean when you said when this kind of comes to an end, come May 31st and this ends, would then this come back to council to determine whether we want to continue with outdoor dining? Is that what the anticipation is?
So we would reevaluate this around May to see what the social distancing requirements are and whether or not we can have events this summer in the village. And then if events were going to be allowed, then probably leave it at, you know, let it terminate at the end of May. But we can bring it back for discussion to the city council to get direction.
Okay.
If we can't do, if gathering cannot take place and we're not moving forward with any events, we'll bring it back to see if you'd like to extend it further.
Okay. Yeah, lots of moving parts, I understand. Okay, seeing no more questions from council, we can move to public comment. Do we have any public comment on this item?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any comments either from the attendees or for email on this item.
Thank you, Larry. Okay, so we'll come back to council for deliberation and a vote.
I move approval of staff recommendation.
I second.
Thank you. Any other comments? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and take this to roll call.
Thank you. Councilmember Bertrand?
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser?
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story?
Aye.
And Mayor Brooks?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. This item passes unanimously. So we'll go ahead now. Thank you, Katie.
Thank
you. Move on to item 9B, review of council appointments. I believe, Chloe, is this your item?
Yes, thank you. So bear with me one moment. Everyone should be able to see me and hear me. And I'm going to share my screen and bring up our PowerPoint here. Okay. Can everyone see the PowerPoint as a presentation? Or are you seeing my notes here?
We see your the presentation and your slide deck on the right-hand side with your notes.
Okay. Give me one second. I apologize.
Take your time.
Thank you. I'm having empathy for everyone that's had trouble with this through the 9 months we've been doing it. And there we go. Okay, thank you for your patience. So this is should be a familiar item. It's very similar to what council and thank you, Mayor, you reviewed in December. We just have a few remaining city advisory bodies and multi-jurisdictional bodies for council and yourself, Mayor, to appoint members of the public or yourselves to represent the city of Capitola. So without further ado, I'm going to get started with this is a list of the appointments tonight. There's a few more of the city advisory bodies. We'll be reviewing those four commissions and committees. And then just a few more multi-jurisdictional bodies as well, but we'll try to do this relatively quickly. So for city bodies, the Architecture and Site Review Committee, all members are currently expiring or have technically at the end of December, and they're listed here. They all wish to continue, and we did not receive any applications, so I'll turn to council to review and make appointments. I'll be taking notes as you do that. They're not individually appointed since they have different roles. You'll notice, for example, Frank Fanton is the designated architect. So council just needs to approve as a group that these four individuals are okay with everyone.
Okay, are you looking for a motion?
Yes, just you don't need to do a roll call vote, just an agreement that I think similar to what we did in December, that this list looks all right, and then I will make note of that.
Okay, I see Council Member Bertrand hand raised.
Well, if you don't need a motion, I'd just like to say I think this list looks all right, and they've served us well. Reports I've read, they've certainly participated and lent to our decisions in the city planning.
Thank you.
Okay, do you prefer us to go one by one, Chloe, or do you want us just to raise our hands?
A raise of hands would be perfect. I think that'll be easier. I can see you all, I believe. Good? Okay, thank you. I appreciate it. So moving forward, 1 second. Okay, I'm so sorry. Being in three different places doesn't always work. Okay, so moving forward to Commission on the Environment, similar situation. However, each member is individually appointed by one of yourselves. So in this case, I think you can go through and just down the list if you want to just make appointments. Again, no applications were received, and all members did indicate they were interested in continuing. In this case, a review of your council representative would be appropriate as well. Just tell me how you want to move forward, and I'll make note of that. But if you want to start one by one to make an appointment.
Yes, sure.
Madam Mayor.
Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, I had notified Chloe that I would drop off at council representative. I did talk to Moreau about it. She has some questions, and I do have an appointment that I would like to make.
Great.
Okay. So then, Councilmember Kaiser, would you like to make your appointment? I'll start from the bottom up then.
Great.
I guess I don't have an appointment for this one, but
would you like to continue with Peter Wilk then, since he's showing interest to continue, and then if any changes, you can circle back?
Yeah.
Great.
Okay. I was going to appoint him, but that's fine.
Anyway, whatever works.
Okay. Maybe I could press that. Let's see, where are we? And then Chloe, I'll go ahead and keep Michelle on. Councilmember Story.
Yes, if Meredith is willing to continue, I'm happy to have her in that capacity.
Thank you.
Okay, and then Councilman Peterson.
Yeah, I'm happy to keep Kathleen on.
Thank you so much.
Okay, and then Chloe, we can circle back about Councilmember Kaiser and Bertrand's appointments.
Absolutely.
Once we get a little clarification. Okay, we can move on to the next one then.
Thank you. Okay. And okay. For this, this is the Finance Advisory Commission. It looks more complicated than it is. I have it written out at the top here what we need to do. Based on the resolution, the mayor and vice mayor may choose to serve on this commission or appoint a council member in their place. The remaining three council members then appoint members of the public, and a business representative is approved in addition by the full council. So I have this written out here. The three incumbent listed here did indicate they wanted to return. This vacant person is a non-person because the previous appointee of Vice Mayor Story did not want to return. So there's three positions, hopefully made by three council members. Paul Esty and Laura Alioto have indicated they'd like to continue. We have one applicant listed here, Anthony Ravai, and the business representative, whom is approved by all of you, would like to continue. His name is Pete Cullen, and he has served in the past. So if we want to start with the mayor and the vice mayor letting me know if you'd like to be on the committee or appoint someone else, from there, the three remaining council members can make their appointments. Does that
make sense? Okay. Yep.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. So I'll be staying on as the mayor.
Wonderful.
For the finance. Vice Mayor Story?
Well, are there any other council members that are interested in being on the Finance Advisory Commission? Oh. If there aren't, then I'll sit as vice mayor.
Thank you.
Do I still get an appointment?
If the mayor and the vice mayor serve, you do not appoint a member of the public. You are your own appointee, if you think of it that way.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, and then we'll just assume that Council Member Kaiser, your appointment would be where we see Mr. Bottorff's appointee in the past, and it looks like Mr. Esty wants to stay on. Would you be comfortable with that?
That's fine. I did ask Anthony Ravai to apply.
Okay, perhaps he could fill the vacancy.
Sure.
Would there be a vacancy? Chloe's down the way.
Yes.
Well, let's continue. And then Councilmember Bertrand?
Yeah, I'd like to appoint Paul Esty.
Chloe, maybe you can connect the dots for
yes.
us. Just
you want me to, I can see
yeah.
how this would work.
Looks like there's enough people, and then you can just attach it to the council member as you see.
Absolutely. So if Councilmember Bertrand, if you'd like to appoint Paul Estee, that's fine. We still need Councilmember Peterson and Councilmember Kaiser to appoint someone, and the remaining two people are Anthony Ravai and Laura Alioto. As long as Councilmember Peterson is fine with Ms. Alioto, then Councilmember Kaiser, you can appoint whom you asked, Anthony Ravai. So thank you very much. We'll move on with that as a decision. And continue through. Thank you. This last City Council advisory body, we just want to confirm, as you had asked Vice Mayor Story, if you needed to be reviewed as the Art and Cultural Commission representative. You are the incumbent representative, and just wanted to make that official here with Council reviewing that tonight and making a decision, a determination on that. So I'll just hear from you, Council and Mayor, if that is how we want to move forward.
Yeah, as long as Vice Mayor Story is happy to continue, I'd be happy to have him. I would agree with him.
Thank you. I'm happy to continue, but if another council member is interested in arts and cultural, I've been on it for many years, so I'm happy to step aside.
I see Council Member Bertrand's hand up.
Oh, no, sorry, I didn't take it down, sorry.
Okay, so it looks like there's a consensus.
Wonderful, thank you. Okay.
Right, thank you.
Okay, and now we're moving forward. Thank you for your patience, everyone, with these. We're moving into multi-jurisdictional bodies. So we have the first one here, Criminal Justice Council of Santa Cruz County, to review the current representatives. Currently, they are Mayor Brooks and Councilmember Bertrand.
Okay, is there any other interest from Council or CJC? I see Councilmember Peterson hand raised.
Yeah, I have an interest in serving on this body if it's the will of the mayor and the council.
Great. And is that a second person, Chloe, or is that alternate for
In this case, it is a second seat. I feel that other jurisdictions have their city manager on this council. However, another member of City Council can take, in this case, his place, which we have done, it seems, for quite some time, I believe.
I'm fine with Kristen taking my place, and I don't know if Yvette, you're going to take the position, but it's fine with me.
Okay.
Do we have any interest in if I were to step down from another council member?
I can do it as well. I think, yeah.
Okay. So we have Councilwoman Kaiser and Councilwoman Peterson for the CJC.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. For the Santa Cruz County Flood and Water Flood Control and Water Conservation District, again, we're looking to review these current representatives. Currently, that is Councilmember Bertrand with the alternate as Councilmember Peterson. I'll let you review.
Okay, would the two of you like to remain, or is there interest from any other council members at this time?
Yeah, I'll be glad to remain.
Yeah, I'm fine being the alternate unless anyone else is interested in it.
It doesn't look like there's any.
Thank you. Moving forward, the Santa Cruz County Library Financing Authority will be meeting here at the end of the month, and time to review these representatives. Currently, Councilmember Bertrand and Councilmember Peterson is the alternate.
Okay.
Yeah, if there's someone else interested, that's fine with me. Or I could switch with Kristen.
What's the time commitment, Jacques?
The meetings go very quick and they're late. So pretty typically, it's 6 o'clock, pretty typically you're there and I don't know, 15 minutes later you're out.
Oh, is it monthly?
No, it's not monthly at all.
Oh.
I can't remember the frequency.
I believe I was told this is an annual meeting.
Yeah.
So.
Or twice annually or something like that. It's very seldom.
So a okay. Slow commitment, yes.
Yeah. But if you're not there, then there's a lot of gears that grind down. So it's sure. Very important to be there.
Yes.
I can explain it if you'd like, just a very short explanation. So
sure.
The LFA, the Library Financing Authority, basically takes in all of the money that this county gets for library services. And it's charged with distributing it to between the two different library systems in the county. So it's pretty procedural because the formula is 23% to Watsonville and 77% to us. But twice a year, the money comes in and has to get dispersed back out. So it is, like Councilmember Bertrand said, usually about a 5-minute meeting. And like Councilmember Bertrand said, it's very important to be there because the money has to get distributed and we need a quorum.
Right. You cannot forget this meeting.
Mm-hmm. So does it sound like we want to switch roles, Council Member Peterson?
That's fine with me if you want to do that, Jacques.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Thank you. I'll note that and I'll let, I believe her name is Helga, I'll let the board clerk know as well.
Right.
Okay. So next we have another review of our current representation for the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Commission. They generally meet the first Thursday of each month. It was a little bit of a mix-up on my end that the first meeting was this morning of the same day. I apologize that this wasn't taken care of in December. However, if it's the will of the council, they are open to anyone from our council serving. So just time to review those current representatives, which are Councilmember Bertrand and the alternate as Councilmember Story.
Would you like to continue, or is there another?
I'd definitely like to continue. My head's still reeling from a six-hour meeting today. The meetings actually go fairly long. Six is a little bit longer than normal, though, because of the issue with the alternate analysis.
And
yes.
Councilmember Story, are you willing to continue as the alternate?
Yes.
Okay. Is that what you needed, Chloe?
Yes, that's great. Keep as is. Thank you. And we're almost done, I promise. This is actually, I believe this is the last multi-jurisdictional body. This is the Santa Cruz Library Advisory Commission. So related to the Finance Advisory Commission, but different. And this is something council will need to appoint someone. So it's not a member of council serving, it is a member of the public. And I just wanted to note that our previous city representative was Mr. Bob White, who passed away earlier in 2020, and I believe was very beloved and worked very hard for all the libraries in our area, but for Capitola. So I wanted to say thank you to him and to mention that we had two applications from Laura Alioto and Michael Termini. So we just need a council, full council approval and appointee to this committee.
And I just need clarification, that one or both we can appoint?
Oh, I'm sorry, just one person. Thank you for asking.
Okay. Does council have a recommendation on which of the applicants to move forward for this body?
I would recommend that we appoint Mike Termini.
I'll second that.
I agree.
Yeah, okay. Mike's been very, very involved and instrumental in moving the library forward. So he's definitely a good appointee.
Okay,
I will agree with my colleagues on this one to appoint Michael Termini.
Thank you so much. And I believe, yes, that is the last one. Thank you for your patience. I will let everyone know who needs to know. And thank you for another year of service.
And Chloe, there just might be some question about the Commission on the Environment, whether a council member needs to be on that. I think we're looking into that.
Okay.
So before we just backtrack, if that's necessary, do we have any council members interested in participating on the Commission on the Environment?
I can confirm that there is one council seat on the Commission on the Environment. So I think we're short. I believe we're short one council member on the COE at this point.
Okay.
Thank you.
Councilmember Kaiser, Story, anyone?
Is Jacques, are you on it right now?
No, like we talked earlier, I want to be opening that position for someone else on the city council. And
okay.
I was interested in appointing Peter Wilk, but and I did talk to Peter if he was interested. So. Maybe there's some confusion here. I was uncertain what happened actually.
Yeah, just depending on meeting time, I can do that one. Do we know when it means?
Okay.
Well, Steve would.
So, Director Jesberg, Steve, I think he's on the call and he can talk about the Commission on the Environment meetings. I believe they're bi-monthly.
Right now, the commission meets quarterly, although we haven't set the schedule for 2021 yet. That'll be one of the issues. And it's met from anywhere from monthly to bi-monthly. We're currently on a quarterly schedule. We do meet in the evenings around 6 o'clock. The day is flexible that we find a room. We try and find a day that works best for all the members.
Okay. Yeah, I can take that one. Sorry, Jacques, if that was confusing.
No, it's okay. So then I would like to appoint Peter Wilk as my appointee.
Okay.
Appointment.
I'll make note of that and I'll reflect that in the minutes. Thank you. And thank you, Councilmember Kaiser, for joining that.
Yeah.
Okay.
City Manager, Jamie, is there anything else we're missing before we move on to the next item?
I think we got everything done that we needed to this evening.
Yes.
For the appointment.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chloe. Okay, we're gonna now move on to item 9C, consider entering a lifeguard contract with the City of Santa Cruz Marine Safety Division. Do we have a staff report?
Yes, thank you, Mayor, Council members. I will take a minute to share my screen. Right. So the item for you this evening is the beach lifeguard contract. Since 2012, the city has been contracting with the Santa Cruz Marine Safety Division to provide our beach lifeguard services for the season. Extensions were authorized through 2020. However, the two entities mutually terminated that for the 2020 contract due to the pandemic. So under the proposed agreement, which is a two-year agreement that was decided in the best interest for both organizations, as it takes a great deal of effort in hiring and organizing, that 2 years would be a mutually agreeable term for this agreement, as well as to continue with an opportunity for the city and Central Fire to work towards providing a full range for lifeguard services in 2023. So the proposed agreement with the City of Santa Cruz would be a $91,119 contract. This is an $8,000 increase for increased hours and personnel costs. If approved, that this annual contract will be included in the appropriate budget fiscal year 2021 and fiscal year 2022. So the recommended action is to authorize city manager to sign a two-year contract not to exceed $91,500 annually with the City of Santa Cruz Marine Safety Division for Capitola Beach Lifeguard Services. And I'm available for questions at this time.
Thank you, Nikki. Do we have any questions? I see Vice Mayor Story's hand raised.
Thank you, Mayor. Nikki, I noticed in the contract under compensation, from page, agenda packet page 237, that the Santa Cruz has given themselves the option to increase the cost, or kind of, and it's unclear as to under at what period. And I was just curious as to what was anticipated and why that term was put into the contract.
Perhaps city manager might have a deeper explanation for this, but I believe that it was included in the contract in order to compensate for any unexpected staff increases or operational increases.
Is the staffing like based on the numbers of people on the beach at any given summer, or is it number? I just thought they just did it based on the number of lifeguard stands.
So they staff to a ratio. They provide a certain number of staff for each tower during a set number of hours, depending upon the day of week or the weekend. And then they also provide tower services for holiday weekends and potentially any events. And so I believe that that potential increase in the event that any of those hours were to be changed for an elongated event or something along those lines, then that's part of it, as well as any unexpected operational costs.
Okay. So nothing to be concerned there about surprise additional expenses to the city budget.
I get the impression that it was maybe a standard part of the contract. So I'm not sure if the city manager could confirm or add to that.
Nikki, this is Mayor Brooks. This is Larry. It looks like the city manager might have dropped off due to technical, but I have a little bit of history. Is that sometimes we have to extend the season? I don't know if that's what, and that's where some of that's built in. Sometimes they kind of give us the budget from, I believe it's Memorial Day to Labor Day, and sometimes we ask them to, because of conditions, weather, that sort of thing, to extend beyond that time frame. So we've always had a little extra for that if necessary. But it is the fees are the charges, I believe, are based on the number of staff that need to staff the towers during the hours of the agreement.
And I see our city manager back. Oh. Jamie, do you have sound? We see you.
I do. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm going to have to ask my son, I think, to get off Netflix. But so the language in the contract that talks about renegotiation was really put in there just as, like, these are two public agency partners. And on the off chance that we have an endless summer and we continue lifeguard services much further than we ever anticipated, that would be an opportunity for them to come back and say, hey, you know, we're not a money-making venture here, but we're also not trying to lose money either. And it was just really that kind of bailout clause, if you will. So that's the purpose behind it. They've never asked for a different amount than the actual amount that's in the contract.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Let me just check. Okay. Seeing none, we'll go ahead and take this to public comment. Any public comments or questions?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees looking to comment, and I do not see any emails on this item.
Okay, thank you. So we'll bring this back to council for deliberation and a motion. I see Council Member Vice Mayor Story's hand raised.
Oh, That was from previous, but I will just move staff recommendation.
I'll second.
We have a first by Vice Mayor Story and a second by Councilmember Bertrand. Can I have a is there any more conversation or discussion from the council? Okay, seeing none, we'll go ahead. Can we have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
And Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, that item passes unanimously. We'll now move on to item 9D. This is the Junior Guard Instructor Training Contract. Do we have staff presentation?
Yes, thank you, Mayor, Council members. Let me take a minute and share my screen. All right, so the item before you is the Junior Guard Instructor Training Contract. So CFLSA, which is the organization that has a oversight for our Junior Guard competitions, as well as standards for under USLA, the standards for open water lifeguard training and certification. They recommend that Capitola Junior Guard program is trained by a lifeguard agency, and Central Fire is we have contracted with them since 2019 to provide the open water lifeguard training to our Junior Guard instructors, as they are a exceptionally qualified organization to provide that training. Under the proposed agreement, Central Fire would be providing services for two seasons, the 2021 and 2022 season. The services would include conducting eligibility for employment swim tests, as well as providing open water lifeguard training according to the USLA standards. That would also include Title 22 and CPR training. The fiscal impact of this, the proposed central contract for 2021 is $16,000. This is a $3,000 increase from any prior years. And the contract for 2022 is that $17,000. So the recommended action for you is to authorize the city manager to sign a two-year contract not to exceed $17,000 annually with the Central Fire, that should be changed, district for lifeguard testing and training services. And I should note that the additional materials that were provided to you earlier in the meeting is a revision of the contract that was included in the packet with minor edits, removing the word protection to any statement that would refer to the district, the organization, Central Fire District, as well as removing interim from now Fire Chief Wallbridge's title. I'm available for questions at this time.
Thank you, Nikki. Do we have any questions from council on this item?
I should note that the members from Central Fire District are also currently in attendance.
Thank you. I do not see any questions from council on this item. Do we have any? I see Council Member Bertrand. Do you have a question?
Yes, technology thing. So now with the consolidation, are we talking with the same people to do the training? Has that changed?
So
there's continuity there, basically.
Are you speaking directly to the staff that we would be working
yes.
with?
Yes.
So no, that has not changed. From the beginning in 2019, the primary person that I've been working with is Captain Scott Hartway, and that will continue. We greatly appreciate his leadership in organizing this training and appreciate Chief Wallbridge's continuance of that relationship.
Yeah, I observed some of the training and I was very impressed with the professional approach and also the ability to get the youth to participate. It was definitely a good experience for everyone involved, I think.
Thank you. For the question, Councilmember Bertrand, do we have any public comment at this time?
Mayor Brooks, yes, I see. It looks like Chief Wallbridge is, I'm going to put him on to talk.
Good evening. Can everybody hear me okay?
All right.
Mayor Brooks and the rest of the City Council, Jamie Goldstein and Nikki Bryant, I just want to appreciate the opportunity to talk to everybody and just do a little clarification. Is Central Fire Protection District and soon to be Central Fire District is going to still be your fire department, and we're still here to deliver the service that we have before. Just now we're going to have more depth within our ranks by cooperating and ultimately consolidating with Aptos La Selva, hopefully by February 4th of this year. I think that that will give rise to our ability in 2023 to provide a full spectrum of services to the city of Capitola and beyond. I want to thank everybody for their consideration in the proposed contract, and I obviously greatly support it as we've already signed off on it, and look forward to many years of a good cooperative effort between the city and Central Fire District. And that's the end of my comments.
Thank you, Chief Wallbridge, and congratulations on your new role. We'll go ahead and bring this back to council for deliberation. If there are no other public comments.
I move to authorize the city manager contract as described in the staff report.
Second.
Nope, that's fine too.
We have a first from Councilmember Bertrand and a second from Councilwoman Peterson. Can I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. This item passes unanimously. We'll go ahead now and move on to, thank you, Nikki. Thank you, Chief Wallbridge, for your time. We'll go ahead and now move on to item 9E, consider increasing the number available surf and coffee permits for 2021. Do we have a staff report?
Yes. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Perfect. Good evening, Mayor Brooks and Council. I'm here this evening to discuss the morning parking permit, otherwise known as the surf and coffee permit program. And I'll provide a little background. So back in 2008, Council directed staff to institute this parking program. And the intent was to allow morning parking for beachgoers and visitors to come down to the village and enjoy the village and also the surfers. And so the program itself has been, as far as the program, what it is it's 2 hours of free parking 7 days a week from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. And what we do is we offer 50 permits a year. And since 2008, we've had a really successful program. The last 4 years, though, we've actually sold out of those permits, and then this year we actually sold out of the 50 permits within just 2 days, which started some conversation with folks as far as wanting additional permits. And so at that point, we reached out to the BIA and some other locals down in the village, and just to see if there was further interest in that. And the BIA supported it, as well as the locals that were down there, kind of that used that. I say locals, but it's not just Capitol locals, it's others that also use it. And so the proposal this evening is that we recommend increasing the permits by 25. So that would raise the current 50 to 75, if that's your direction. And if you have any questions, I'm here.
Thank you, Andy. Do we have any questions from council? Seeing none. Oh, thank you. I see you, Councilmember Kaiser. Go ahead.
Hi, thanks. That took me a second. So these are year-round, yes?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, I wasn't super familiar with the program. And then, so obviously, like you're saying, a lot of locals utilize it, but then maybe some non-locals. And I just, I know that when private beach, you had to pay to get like a key or whatever, but that you, if you provided a, just a bill with your address on it, if you lived within a certain distance, you got a little cheaper price. And then maybe if you weren't technically local, like, I don't know, whatever jurisdiction we wanted to decide, maybe that cost is a little expensive. I mean, 50 bucks is like a steal, I think, but I'm just saying, I think we could maybe do more. It does seem like it's in super high demand. So, I mean, obviously I'm fine with how it is now, but just a thought.
Okay, and congratulations on your new appointment. But yes, there is no residence requirement to purchase the permits, and the permits are $50, and we have 50 of them. So that's our current model, and like I said, if the recommendation today is to move forward with increasing that, but other options are obviously up to your direction.
Okay, I think we've answered Councilwoman Kaiser's question. We'll go ahead and bring your point back for deliberation after we go to public comment if you want to talk a little bit more about your proposal there, Councilwoman. I see Councilmember Bertrand hand raised. Do you have any questions at this time, Councilmember?
Yeah, I was just wondering, you did go to the Bertrands. Is there any expressed concern about competing for places that other regular customers might use for the restaurants and such there? Or are they just, this is totally fine because there's not many people that come down to the Esplanade at that time of the day?
Yes, so during the early morning hours, there's not a lot of parking, or there's a lot of available parking. And so the 8 to 10, there is available parking. One of the original intents behind it was the surfers didn't want to get out of the water to pay the meter, so they want to stay in the water longer. And then as it progressed, the businesses were really happy about those that then enjoy the coffee or those different things. So we reached out to the BIA, and they were very supportive of anything that would encourage folks to come down and patronize our businesses or enjoy the outdoor activities that we have, and the surfing and stuff like that. So
thank you, Captain.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I see Councilwoman Peterson's hand raised.
Thank you. To Margo, Councilwoman Kaiser's point, do we have any idea of how many of these permits have gone to out of county residents?
I don't have that answer. I know that the, like I said, this year, the folks that are aware of it were very quick to purchase them. But I don't have the exact breakdown of out of county versus like Capitola proper residents or Santa Cruz, that type of thing.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Vice Mayor Story.
Yeah, thank you. Andy, will this increase meet the current waiting list or the demand, including Capitola residents?
I think the 25 is a reasonable step at this point. And it's one of those things that, you know, if you go too far, then it can take away from that metered parking. So finding that balance, we feel that the 25 is a good kind of step at this point. But, you know, it's up to your direction.
Do you have a current waiting list? Do you know how many people have applied after the supply was exhausted?
We do not have a waiting list. But we did and continue to get calls seeking the permits, and we've just been telling them they sold out.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions from council members? Okay. We'll go ahead and take this to public comment. Do we have any public comments for this item?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees asking a question, and I do not have any emails on this item.
Okay, thank you. We'll bring this back to council for further discussion and a motion.
Madam Mayor, before you do, would you mind if I just offered a little bit of information that might be helpful? We're going to be talking about next year's goals and objectives coming up here, I think, in February, asking the council for sort of what our work plan, what are big things we're going to work on. And one of the things the staff is going to toss out there as a potential item for the council to consider for next year is really looking at the sort of what we charge for parking in the village. If rather than maybe just tweaking the rates on this one, you might want to consider, if we're not going to make that decision tonight, but if we're going to talk more holistically about parking in the village and rates, that could be on the horizon for next year. And so that might be a place to punt the conversation on that issue for this permit in particular. Just wanted to put that out there.
Yeah, I think as far as this issue goes, I think just adding on to what we've already done, it would suffice. And then I think there's room for us to explore going forward, you know, just better parameters or how we want to run it. You know, it seems like it's in demand, so let's do it.
I would just add to the questions that were asked of you, Andy. Maybe we can start telling how many phone calls we're getting, just to see. So when we circle back to this conversation, and we that might be a helpful some helpful information from this point on. Any other comments, Councilmember Bertrand?
Yeah, I put forth to be agendized discussing the permits for parking downtown. I'm glad to see staff's working on that, and I agree with Margot. At least maybe I'm getting the intent. I would like to have this program mostly for locals. And, you know, if there's a, you know, influx of non-locals that are taking advantage of it, well, that's good, but then maybe we should have a different way to deal with it. So that is a discussion for next year when we talk about our goals. I totally agree.
Thank you. And I would just add that perhaps we can look at the effects of how the for Coastal Commission, if that's an issue. If we're taking notes there. Any other comments? Okay, we can look for a motion at this time. Okay, Councilmember Kaiser, do we have a second?
I'll second. Nope. Kristen, you good.
Councilmember Bertrand.
No. Okay.
Can we have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. This item 9E passes unanimously. Thank you, Andy, for your time today. Okay, so you didn't think you could make my first, I would make my first meeting without a few mistakes. So I'm gonna actually ask council to go back to item on the consent calendar, item D and E. If I can have a motion to approve consent items D and E.
I think we may have. Okay, that's right. I'm sorry.
She hasn't. But Sam had some questions, I thought, so.
No, these are items, consent items D and E that I forgot about when we made the first motion. So I
Oh, that's correct, that. Yeah.
If I can have a motion for consent items D and E.
I will move consent approval of item D and E from the consent calendar.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Can we have a roll call, please?
Yes, Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, now we're going to go back to general government. We're going to look at item 8A. Council, our Vice Mayor Story asked that we pull this item. So, Councilmember Story, would you, you had some questions about this item.
Yeah, on the minutes, on agenda packet 13 at the top, it says, there's a typo, I won't raise that, but just that the committee has suggested setting aside between $4 to $600,000. My recollection, it was just $600,000 was from the Finance Advisory Committee. So I assume that that's a typo. So I just wanted to raise that, but I also wanted to, in the process of my going through that and seeing that, I start to think about, well, how official are these minutes and how accurate and close do they need to be, since now, we have video storage of all the actual meetings, which I assume would be more official. So I guess I wanted to ask that question. About these written minutes, the action minutes, and how carefully we should be trying to read them and make sure that they're accurate.
Councilmember Story, so the first piece is, I think that's actually verbatim what I said at the meeting, because I do believe the Finance Advisory Committee recommended between $400,000 and $600,000, but it's $400,000 to $600,000, I believe, is what.
Correct.
But
not $4 to $600.
Right. So, I think I actually said $400,000 to $600,000, but in the way you verbally articulate that, it doesn't translate into the written word as clearly. So we'll make that correction. So I'm sure you recall that historically the minutes were very voluminous. The minutes for each meeting would be 10 plus pages. We went to action minutes based on the exact point that you raised. I want to say about 7 or 8 years ago, the fact that the meeting video is actually online and is a far better record than any kind of minutes could ever be. And so that's, we have the action minutes, but we do still include these short summaries of the discussion. So arguably, we shouldn't be, because the video record exists, which probably provides a better record, but we have been doing it this way. So I'd be open to input if the council said that we should really rely on the video record and should stick to the action minutes, which would really just be the motion, the second, and the vote, and we wouldn't be recording the debate. And I'll leave it to the city attorney if she has any opinion about how carefully to review these.
As far as how carefully the council reviews them, I'd like them to be accurate, because I am often the one who needs them. It's often if I'm trying to track what actions the council has taken on an item that we might be bringing back to you, at times over a year later, and especially if it's something that you didn't vote on and now we're asking you to vote on. So I actually use them at times. Somewhat frequently, actually, I look back at the minutes of a prior item. I would imagine that staff does too in some cases. So I'd like them to be accurate. I know that a lot of cities move to action minutes for the exact reason that City Manager Goldstein said. So whether they're action minutes or more voluminous, it is more useful to me and perhaps others who are looking at them if they have some detail about the debate. But if they don't, we can always go back and watch the video. The video isn't as efficient as looking at the minutes. So that's, I think, why cities are sticking with them. It's not uncommon for council members to correct them at meetings. So my impression is that council members generally review them prior to meetings.
Okay. So I get that we should continue to exercise due diligence and making sure that the written minutes are an accurate reflection of the summary of the meeting. Okay.
Okay. And since we're treating item 8A as a regular agenda item as general government, we're still on questions. So Council Member Bertrand, do you have a question?
I was just following up on what Samantha said, and I put a question to city council members. As Sam said, this is more efficient, but put yourself in the position of the general public, going to a website and trying to find out, what was actually recorded and then going to. So, I ask city council members to support that we do, an abbreviated. Realizing that you have the link to go to the video, but most people use the abbreviated summary. That's a question I pose to people to in your mind when you think about this.
Thank you. Any other questions for this item? None? Okay, can we see if there's any public comment on item 8A?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any public comments either via attendee or the public or the email.
Okay, we'll go ahead and bring this back to council for more discussion and a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Okay, I see a first and a second, and I would just like to add that I'm in agreement with Councilmember Bertrand that I too enjoy the additional information on the minutes. I think it would be cumbersome to go through a video when looking for some straightforward information. So I just would like to add that. Chloe, if we can have a roll call, please.
Absolutely. Councilmember Bertrand?
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser?
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story?
Aye.
Mayor Brooks?
Aye. Okay, now on to item 8C. Councilmember Story, you asked that item 8C be pulled from the consent. Did you have some questions?
I did. Actually, just one question, and this is concerning our audit for year end, June 30th, 2020. On page 7 of the written audit report, I noticed that it reflects that our unrestricted fund balance went from about a negative 10.5 million to a negative 12.8 million, an increase of about 2.3 million. And my question is, I know the explanation is related to our unfunded pension liability. My question is, did that increase of 2.5 million, is that all attributable to the unfunded pension liability? I'll put it in another way, did that liability increase by 2.5 million?
Hi, Councilmember Story. Yes, you are absolutely correct. That is, it was 2.2 of that is attributable to the OPEB UAL, or not OPEB, I'm sorry, to the PERS UAL.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. That's what I suspected. And I guess, maybe when we go have our next, pretty soon in the spring, we're going to be visiting our next year's budget. We should, I would like to maybe have a further discussion of that particular balance sheet item and the pension liability. And why, you know, I was a little concerned that it increased so much in that 1 year period. So thank you.
Sure, absolutely.
Okay, any other questions on this item? Seeing no questions, we'll take this to public comment.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees asking questions or any emails on this item.
Okay, thank you. And we'll bring this back to council for further discussion and a motion.
I move that we accept the report.
I agree. I second it.
We have a first from Vice Mayor Story and a second from Councilmember Bertrand. Can I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand?
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser? I see. I'll take that as
we didn't hear your member Kaiser. We're muted.
Oh, aye. Sorry.
Thank you. Councilmember Peterson?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story?
Aye.
Mayor Brooks?
Aye.
Thank you.
All right, so this takes that, or that item passes unanimously. We'll go on to item 10, adjournment. I just wanted to say thank you, council. Thank you, council member Kaiser. Congratulations on your election again. Thank you, staff and participants, for being here tonight. So please remember to find the good in others and in yourself. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.
Goodbye.